Water is the essence of life, but we often underestimate its significance. While we enjoy access to safe and clean drinking water, there are three questions that might not have crossed our minds before, and this will be the focus of my speech. First question, why is water pollution a global issue? Second question, why do we call it the woman's problem? And third question, how can we use new technology to solve the global problem of water pollution? Let's start with the first question. In 2024, 2 billion people lack access to clean and safe drinking water. That means that 1 in 4 people living on this planet does not have access to clean water. 40 billion hours is the time people in sub-Saharan Africa spend every single year in search for clean water. 40 billion hours is also time people in France spend working. Now, why do we call it the woman's problem? Women and girls around the world spend 200 million hours every single day in search for clean water. They carry the burden of bringing clean water to their households, sometimes investing up to 8 hours a day just to bring a single bucket of clean water, thus missing on education. And while girls go search for water, the boys go to school. This is where the heart of gender inequalities begins. Therefore, water pollution is not just a global issue, it truly is a gender problem. So, what can we do about this problem? Well, I realized that finding new technologies is not just a way. We need to find ways how we can introduce more women into the decision-making spaces. And it's not just about the technology, but it's about the diversity. Now, when people ask about my story as a water scientist and entrepreneur, I often say that I did not actively choose to work in the water sector. Instead, it was water itself that chose me, guiding my path ever since I developed a deep passion for it. When I was 14, I visited India. My mom and I backpacked the suburbs of Mumbai. And that's when I, for the first time ever, saw black rivers. I saw people struggling with waterborne diseases. And most importantly, I saw girls my age using this water during their periods, putting their health at their greatest. So at that moment, I decided making cleaning polluted water my life mission. When I returned back home from this eye-opening trip to my home country, Slovakia, I decided that I didn't want to keep waiting because I was just 14 years old, but I decided that I wanted to find solutions for this global issue. So at the age of 14, I created a small lab in my attic and I started the first simple experiments. And I learned that technology can be used to solve some of the world's biggest global challenges. I fell in love with quantum chemistry. It's an abstract computing method which allows you to create new materials with the use of computers before you even synthesize them, before you have these physical materials in your hands. And so I decided to use quantum chemistry software to discover new materials of substances which could purify polluted water from E. coli, bacteria, viruses, and pesticides. Materials which would be affordable for some of the most vulnerable communities from around the world and would be efficient at the same time. It took me 3 years to master quantum chemistry. And at the age of 17, I used quantum chemistry software to discover a new type of a material capable of purifying polluted water from all these pollutants. And I was awarded a diploma of excellence from the Swedish royal family. And I shook hands with Princess Victoria of Sweden. Now, this moment showed me that my work has a huge potential for saving millions of lives around the world. Being 17 back in Sweden, listening to people who spend their entire lives dedicating to cleaning polluted water. I remember one speaker specifically who said that whoever solves the problem of water pollution does not only get the Nobel Prize in chemistry, but will also get a Nobel Prize for peace, because water is so strongly connected to education of girls and women around the world. And that is motivating me even further. But I also learned that only 3% of all funding dedicated to climate tech goes to water technologies. So even though water pollution is such a huge problem, it's still not receiving the recognition it deserves. And the rest of the funding, more than 46%, goes to industries such as transportation or energy. A few weeks later, after this conference in Sweden, I was awarded a full scholarship to study computer engineering with a specialization in AI at the University of Toronto. And when I came to Canada, I didn't want to abandon my dream of solving the water pollution crisis. But coming to Canada as an international student during COVID was not an easy task, because I really wanted to build a startup, but I didn't have any connections. I later realized that this was far from being the biggest challenge. Actually, only 5% of global CEOs are female. And even the worst thing is that less than 2% of VC funding is dedicated to female-funded startups, meaning that there are not as many people in leadership positions that look like me, and the odds of success are so low. Now, do you remember when I mentioned that women and girls are disproportionately affected by climate change and water pollution? Well, then this really raises the question, why should men be the predominant decision makers when it comes to water pollution and other fields of climate? Well, I think that we need more young women, girls, more members of minorities in decision-making spaces. And we need to educate more people, bring more of them to STEM, to become engineers, entrepreneurs. I think it's our collective responsibility to speak up, use our voices to make a difference. Because I've observed that many global issues are a result of a lack of diversity in those decision-making spaces. Now, this brings me to my third question. How can we use new technology to solve the problem of climate pollution? Well, I started a company called Xatoms. At Xatoms, we are on an intersection of climate change and gender equality. We are using a groundbreaking technology to solve the water pollution. We are discovering new materials which can purify polluted water when exposed to radiation of sun. We are doing it in a way where we are applying artificial intelligence, which helps us analyze huge molecular data sets. And thanks to that, we can find candidates which have the highest potential of cleaning polluted water in an affordable way. Current solutions rely on UV radiation. Well, in our case, we are relying on sunlight. So we can avoid expensive UV reactors and give clean water to vulnerable communities around the world. I think that as residents of Canada, you might wonder, why should I care about problem which is happening thousands and thousands of miles away? The answer is climate change affects us all. If we decide that we want to put our hands into solving this problem, think of new innovative solutions. It's not just about technology anymore, but it's about diversity. It's not about equality, but about equity. In September 2023, I attended UN General Assembly, where I had the chance to address water pollution and the work with the lab Xatoms. I met the founder of Reddit, Alexis Ohanian, who offered me $100,000 grant and made me one of 2776 climate fellows. I was also made as an ambassador of innovation at Baymakers United Foundation, whose goal is to educate 1 million children about water every single year. This is a proof that more and more people, organizations around the world care about solving the water pollution crisis. And even though climate change may not affect us today, it may impact us tomorrow. Many people have experienced with their own skin the results of climate change. For example, when I was a delegate of the G20 in India last summer, I experienced the wettest day Delhi had in decades. Or when I was in Milan at the end of the last summer, I also experienced the hottest day ever measured in Italy. So we also need your ideas for solving this global issue. I envision a world where every drop means life, where every girl can dream beyond her horizons and is not being burdened by a heavy weight of a water bucket. And I was triggered by what I saw in India when I was 14. I decided to take responsibility to my hands, and that brought me on a crazy life journey and completely changed my life. And this is just the beginning of my story. Although water pollution and gender inequality may seem like a huge problem, remember that ocean is also made out of trillions of small particles, and it wouldn't make sense without them. So what will be your drop in this ocean? Thank you so much for being part of my water journey.